Dr. Nall will be in, be doing mode 6, so you'll get some real good information from him as well.
All right, this class is mode 6. You know, I always get nervous because when someone calls you up, you don't talk to the masses, you talk to one guy. I always talk to G. And I said, what class you want? You know, and you know, he goes, what do you got? Sounds like a used car salesman, you know. And I start naming them off, and he goes, yeah, that one, that one, that one. And I go, okay, I'm mode 6, you know. And we, my partner and I, we were like the last two guys to get into mode 6. It seemed to me that all mode 6 was based off Ford mode 6 off ITN. And when I'd try to use it on a GM or a Chrysler, I'd come up, you know, cussing and swearing. Actually, I don't cuss and swear. I'm very religious, but I pay a man to do it for me. He's not religious. But when we look at mode 6, it's really not a world of tids and sids. I kept saying tids and sids. I'm doing math. I'm not doing anything to the car. How about you? I mean, I'm just going on. I'm doing a lot of math here, and I'm sort of like the Rain Man without the math skills. I just don't get it, you know, doing scientific calculator stuff. And then I'm going, what do I do to the car? What do I do to the car? And then along came Ford Mode 6 catalytic converter testing, and I went, okay, now this is what I want. This works flawlessly. This is exactly what I want out of another diagnostic process. Because on Fords, I don't know about this area, but in our area, they're muffler shops, and they tell the guy, do you want a $500 catalytic converter, or do you want a $44 converter? Which one's the customer take? You know, the $44 one, and then it sets a light on, and you're telling him it's a bad cat, and he's going, it's brand new. And then I go, well, you bought the $44 one, you moron. You know, and just, I'm sorry, you're stupid. But stupid should hurt, and you know, and we're not going to talk about table saw safety today. So stupid should hurt, I'm proof of it. But it's not a world of tids and sids. It's actually a world of testing. It's a bunch of testing, and it's just the most intense testing I've ever seen in anything. You know, the definition of mode 6, simple, it's the result of the last time a test ran. Well, the test thing, it was a bit confusing to me. You know, the question is exactly what test? EVAP monitor is an example, the EVAP monitor. Well, you know, we look at the EVAP monitor like it's an individual entity, but it's not. It's a bunch of little tests put into one big test. What is an oxygen sensor resistance test monitor? Do you ever get that failure? You go, okay, the computer had two little leads come out, measure the resistance of the oxygen sensor, and retract. I don't think so. You know, I'm just wondering what they're doing. A monitor is a self-contained program in a PCM that allows a series of diagnostic procedures, and it's going to test a component or a system. So the part that I like is a self-contained program. One monitor, basically, other short of enabling conditions. Short of enabling conditions. And when you talk about enabling conditions, the EVAP monitor is the most wonderful monitor there is because it can't be lower than 40 degrees Fahrenheit and the moon can only be in a third phase and your engine temperature. You read them. And then you're going, why can't I get the monitor run? Because you didn't stand on your head. Oh, I forgot that part. You know, and then along come, what was it, mode 8, that anybody work with mode 8 yet, where you just push the button on your scan tool and it enables EVAP, you take it out on a test, come back, EVAP ran. Where the heck was that 4 years ago? You know, but it's in compartments. And that's so that we avoid collisions in our test procedures. And it basically tests like we should be testing. It's a series of diagnostic procedures. And that's what we do when we test. We do a series. Very rarely do we just put the probe one place and go bad part, change, and collect money. It's always some do this and this is good and do this and this is good. And it's always the last thing we check. So it completely tests a system. Now, We don't even do that. We should be doing it, but we don't. I don't test a complete system. I mean, I can't remember the last time I tested a complete ignition system or a fuel system or an evap system. I stopped testing when? Yeah, when I find a bad part. Boom, you're out of there. I'm in there, and I got to check. What do I want to test the whole thing for? You know, some of those checks are good, I found out. Yeah. Not all of them, right? Do you take credit cards? Please. You know? Now here's something that, this is just the most enlightening information that I can give you today. And G wanted me to start out with telling you that I have too much information. We're never going to reach the bottom of this class. Okay, it's mode 6. What I tell you about one monitor actually transfers to another monitor, but you have the information in front of you. And he was complaining about 100 pages, and the truth is I just stopped. I could have kept going forever, you know. But the EPA makes OBD2 testing part of I&M testing because it's more accurate than IM240 testing. And in O2, when they did that, I went, I don't know if that's true. I don't know if that's true. But then they came up with the test results, and I'm kind of familiar with the way the EPA test. I remember being part of going to Albuquerque, New Mexico, and running the first 50 cars on IM240. I was part of that team. And we went out there because we figured they didn't know anything about maintenance. And we were right. And I remember it took us near 400 cars to get the fifth, and I think we did 47. We just gave up. We ran out of funding, and we never did get 50 cars to pass. And I always remember them, what'd you learn, Doc? I go, you hang an O2 and a cat on anything, it'll pass. Well, no, what did you learn? I go, that's what I learned, you know. Hang an O2 and a cat on anything. You know, in them days, there was one O2 on most cars. But they tested 105 out of 105 vehicles with the mill on, and it failed an IM240 test. 97 out of those failed an IM240 test. That means they took 105 with a mill on, and that's a failure, of course, because you drive up there and that mill's on, and they won't. So that was an easy one. But three vehicles with the mill on passed an IM240 test. They repaired the vehicles with the mill on, and they repaired the failed IM240 cars. The overall HC reduction in emissions was 15.8 grams for OBD2 tested vehicles that failed, and IM240 down to 7, so it won there. And when you look at CO, it's more than double. It's 108 to 303 there. The OBD2 really wins. NOx, 12 to 3.9. And the overall mile per gallon improvement was 60 to 16. And don't be like they were at Vision. And the guy goes, a car got 60 miles to the gallon better? No, 105 together of them got 60 miles together. And I'm going, wait a minute. No wonder they're stop sticking tailpipes. You guys still sticking them or you haven't been, right?
Custom, not the tailpipes.
Yeah. Dave says he sticks the customer, not the tailpipe. Why do we believe that? Because we know him. So I relate this. I try to relate information to as many aspects of this whole world we live in as much as I can. And I say, wow, OBD testing is really, really good. You know, when I knew this because when a Ford monitor failed a cat converter, whether it was brand new or not, it just said, hey, it's cheap. It's not OBD2 certified. It's a cheap one. It's not going to pass. And here, we're spiking the tailpipe. You know, we're testing at the tailpipe. We're looking at front and rear oxygen sensors. We see nothing wrong, but the monitor failed. And the only way we can get it repaired and get the monitor to stop failing, put a new high-dollar cat on it. And so I start rolling all this up in my mind. I go, my goodness, this computer is really a good, helpful tester. It's not like, I don't know, some of you guys seem young. I don't know how young you are. But it was like the when we first started working with codes, I think it was GM in the early 80s, and you get a code and it goes, oh, something's wrong.
You need something.
Yeah, go fix it. The hell is that? Okay. So they decided that it's more effective than INM testing, and I'm not so sure I agree with them, you know? So they come up with these nine test modes. There's only seven on this page. And we've been working with most of them. You know, we've been working with PIDs and freeze frames and DTCs and clear and reset data. And that's the one I stay away from. I mean, I get to a shop, they bring a car to me, and I go, this doesn't have any codes in it. Yeah, we cleared it to see if it'll come back. Well, you cleared a code, and then you know, do you know what you did? You know, you just And now when I ask somebody, did you clear the codes? And they go, yeah. And I go, call me when the light comes back on. So it's like, ooh, something's wrong. You better fix it. You know, I go, been through that era. I didn't like it then. Test mode 5 and 6 have kind of rolled in together, and I think in 07 they kind of divided them back up again, and then some of the scan tool companies tried to divide them up, but basically a lot of mode 5 is rolled into mode 6, and mode 7 I thought was one of the greatest things that ever came down the pike as a pending DTC, and it showed you, hey, this failed one time, it didn't fail again, and I always thought that was cool. Mode 8 is the request for bidirectional, and right now the only thing that's mandatory there by the EPA is you push a button on the scan tool and it bypasses all the enabling conditions for EVAP monitor. And when you have an 07 vehicle, I have not seen any 06. Anybody seen an 06 vehicle with Mode 8 functional? Yeah, I haven't either. I've seen 07s and it's the coolest thing in the world. You push the button and now you go drive the car for 7 minutes and it runs an EVAP monitor. I mean, it's the most amazing thing you've ever seen. I just love it a lot. And mode 9 is when you're reprogramming and stuff and you want all those numbers and stuff, and it's pretty cool. And we're going to spend most of the day, well, the rest of the day on mode 5 that's rolled into mode 6 and mode 6, because that's, oh yeah, that's the name in a class. Oh yeah. Not called mode 1, all right? But you know, I was sitting back there trying to take notes on Dave, and I gave up. I mean, I can't write with my hand, you know, and he's, that stuff's amazing. When did the slide say 160 sensors? Is that what that slide says? 100, I knew there was a lot. You ever like roll up PIDs, you know, on your scan tool, and you go, oh God, I just want TPS. What is all this doing here? You know, it's amazing, you know. They go, EMDOF/93. What's that? I don't know. But when we say mode 6, I always say mode 6 what? To talk about mode 6 in an abstract is just to talk about theory. And I'm like every instructor. I attend every class I can attend. I want to actually look at stuff and you know, try to get a handle on what's new and other people's opinions, you know, I think right now if we were to have an instructor contest, John Thornton would win. I think he's probably the best in the nation at this time. And I sat in Vision on last Sunday, I sat in his J2534 reprogramming class, and I was really, really happy because we only disagreed on one thing, on that disc you have, and we only disagreed on one thing, and him and I are the opposite. I try to make everything simple, and John is into this. I mean, John could fix a space shuttle. I mean, when they're having that trouble, I think, call John. You know, you see on the news, oh, the arm broke, and this broad attacked the other broad. And I mean, it's like, call John. John will make a math formula to get that woman off the other one. I know he will. And it'll work every time. He's phenomenal with his theory. And I'll tell you, the only thing he disagreed on, he doesn't think you should be using. I use a jump start unit. Remember, in the GM version, you have to keep it at battery at 12.5. Well, in Chrysler, it's 13, and BMW, it's 13.3 or 4. Somebody told me last week. Now, I've never done a Beamer, but I use a jump start unit, and I just keep it there, and it's clean, ripple free, and it holds battery voltage throughout the whole program. And John uses a special charging system, Medtronic type charging system thing. So, and whatever. And John doesn't get stuff free, he buys everything, so he really believes in what he uses. So we want to talk about mode 6, and I get everything free, so I just lie. Well, that's good. Mode 6 in a dynamic way. You know, we want to take it to the bay tomorrow. Is this Sunday? No, Saturday. So Monday, we want to get up and start using mode 6. We want to be dynamic about this. There's differences in mode 6, and that was one of the first things that I found frustrating, is the differences between the three domestics. I was at dinner last Saturday night in Vision with a bunch of guys, and some guys starting a hotline. And one of the first things he said is, you can't really use GM Mode 6. And I said, you want to buy a disc? And he bought one. I go, this is cool. And then he bought dinner. I went, wow, I like this guy, you know? But once you understand it and do the research, I like GM Mode 6 a lot better than I like Ford. And Chrysler's Chrysler, but it's still better than Ford. So this class is going to make an assumption that you know how to use your Scantle, that you know how to get Mode 6 data, and Mode 6 data is what we're interested in. And sometimes I can't take good photographs of the Genesis screen, it's too sunny out, or the shop lights are weird, or whatever. So I redraw a lot of stuff. That was weird. Did you do that? You guys with ponytails, I'm telling you. It's trolling. I don't know what happened. The ghost of Mr. Hobbs. Wasn't he having trouble with his computer, you know? But you know, when you gotta be able to go into your personal scan tool, and you gotta get things like test ID, SIDS, component ID, maxes and measured and minimum values. And this is where I always look first. When I'm on a Genesis, I just keep pushing the next button and looking right there. I'm looking for the failed one. Because even though I write these CDs on what all this stuff's about, I can't remember what TID 04 component 20 is. I don't even try to remember, you know? So I'm just looking for that failed one. And then here's a modus. This is not my, I do not use, I actually went and used a guy's modus to get the information, because I don't use snappy tools. But here's test ID and component ID and value and passed. I love that. Passed. You know, this must be a GM, because it's like, we passed? You know, exclamation mark. God, we did something right? Holy cow, you know? How about them? All those names of those modules that he was talking about, you remember them? Because there's a quiz afterwards, you know? What'd you say?
Video.
Yeah.
Acronyms gone wild.
Acronyms go wild. You know, you but.
Yeah, a lot of ingenuity, all that stuff is defined, and it's all on one page, and it's all there right in front of you.
You don't want to wait for the next slides? You want this?
Should we pull them out now or later?
No. Man's not too cool, you know? So we get all these limits, and then I have different scan tools up here, and what he's talking about is right here. We get definitions. We get definitions. Sometimes we get description unavailable. Sometimes we get all kinds of things. And it all depends on what you're using, what software update you got. I am now using an e-scan. I like the tool very, very much. I think it's a great diagnostic tool. It works well with Mode 6. I had an older version recently, and it gave me all these undocumented TIDs and SIDs. And Bernie goes, what are you using, like 001? I go, I don't know. I stole it from somebody. I don't remember where I got it. But, and then he goes, like, you know, here, I'll fix you up. So he got me all, and it reads everything. It reads Chrysler and GM and everything. And those documented TIDs do one very important thing that you're going to see in slides. Get a description. Get a description. TID and SID means nothing to me. Two numbers mean nothing to me. And when they're hexadecimal and you have to get a scientific calculator to straighten it out, I don't care if it's $20 at Walmart or you use the one on your desktop, it's still, to me, a crazy way to do it. So I agree with Mr. Webb that get a tool that addresses it and tells you the definition. Now, the definition sometimes is minimal. Oxygen sensor monitoring, but with a undocumented SID. So sometimes you go, okay, this TID failed an oxygen sensor. Well, did it fail big slope, small slope? Did it fail rich to lean to rich? Did it fail that resistance test? So just the definition sometimes leaves some diagnostic thoughts to be desired. So undocumented, description unavailable. If that's what your scan tool says, stop by Bernie's booth on the way out of here. And I know we keep pushing Bernie. I'm sure these other two guys sell something. So let's go and talk about TIDs and SIDs, because what is a TID and what is a SID? And the arrow represents a monitor. And the arrow down there represents a monitor. And on the left there, I have one part of the monitor, and then I have another part, and then I have another part called lean to rich, and then rich to lean, and then lean to rich switch times, and then switch times again. And as you go down, you got big slope, small slope, half cycles, full cycles, rich amplitude, lean amplitude. So you got time to activity. These are all the definitions of these monitors. There is no one single monitor that is an individual entity. All the monitors are made up of little components, little compartments that do individual testing. Now, when we talk about, and we basically we are broken into mode 6 on Ford. Ford's probably the worst at compartmentalizing all these little pieces. They pretty much tell you, you know what, something's broke. You better go look at it, you know. But GM, on the other hand, and Chrysler, they really expand the definition for you. Heater function, heater current. So there's your monitor. All the little components added up together. Now, you knew this. You didn't need me to tell you this, because somebody gave you an EVAP class, and they told you, oh, it looks for a small leak, looks for a big leak, looks for flow. Same thing with EGR. But you didn't think of it this way. What part am I going to go test? What part am I going to go look at? It's like a catalytic converter. You cannot test a catalytic converter. But when you get it in mode 6 and it fails, you jump all over the front and rear oxygen sensors, and you're spiking that tailpipe, and your gases look good, and it doesn't matter. The monitor didn't like it. So how many? It's like your wife. Look, honey, I painted the barn. And she's cussing you out because it's the wrong color, or there's some run thing there, or else she tells you to fix a window and you cut your thumb off. You know, women are bad, so maybe holding hands is a good thing. I don't know. Got to get off that holding hands thing, though. You know. So here's one little TID and SID. When we get a TID and SID on a scan tool, they're not talking about this. The TID and SID is pointing to something specific. This one says lean to rich switch time. Sometimes it says switch ratio. Sometimes it says switch amplitude. This time we're talking about time. this time we're talking about time. I hate to be redundant. But it's a section of the entire monitor. It's one small piece of the monitor. Now, the descriptions are important, so you know what part of the test failed. And when I want to know what part of the test failed, I put a CD in, I take the cup out of the cup holder. It took me years to figure out what that cup holder was for. And then I put in a CD, and then I start viewing descriptions. And that's what the meat of this class is about, gaining an understanding of what the Mode 6 is actually testing. So, this is a GM. You look up here, it says GM. And then we come down and GM's divided into all except these, and these are the exceptions. So we make a simple selection by clicking on it, and our scan tool said we're into 05, a test ID 05. So we click into that, and what we get is all the possible SIDs for 05. All the possible SIDs for 05, proving my point. It's just not one big thing. In this test ID called 05, look at all the SIDs we have, all the possibilities. Now, why they divide these up is GM's rule. Never build a car 2 days in a row the same way or you're fired. So, you got to understand that's different models, different model years, different engines. This is, you know, you're not going to see all these. These are not all possible on all makes and models. But each one of these is going to be slightly different than the next one. So if you get a TID 5 and a SID 01 and a 41, yeah, that's pretty much the same. But a 01 and a 17 are not the same, not the same component or system test. I know they call them component IDs, but sometimes it's just pointing to a system more than an actual component. Now, in case you haven't worked on brand new cars, they've actually eliminated TIDs and SIDs, and they call them MIDs and TIDs, MIDs and TIDs. And it's really a monitor ID and then a test ID. They've dropped the SID part of it. And that is on vehicles with CAN. That is on vehicles with CAN. They've gone ahead and changed TIDs and SIDs to MIDs, MIDs, and TIDs. So, you know, you just acronym after acronym after acronym up here, it seems like today. So our scan tool said we're into an 02 or a 42. And now watch this, because an 02 and a 42, they say lean to rich threshold voltage. Lean to rich threshold voltage. Now, right away, lean to rich is bad. Going from lean to rich is bad. That's what I'm reading in that description. Now, what does that mean? I mean, you know what? If this was a carburetor, I'd say we're stumbling off idle. We have an off-idle hesitation or something. And I relate everything I read and see and test to something I know from the past. So the test results are in millivolts, thank you. Sometimes the test results are in oogaboogas. Yeah, right, you're laughing. They got some test thing up there, and you go, what the heck is that? You have no idea what it is. You go, I never even heard of that word. You look in the dictionary, and they haven't either. You go, oh, yeah, well, let me go get an ooga-booga meter. But you know, right here, to add to some of the confusion, 0 to 2,000 millivolt, that sounds like 2 volts to me. I hate it when oxygen sensors go to 2 volts, you know. But what we're looking at there, you say, hey, maybe that's a hex number, and you convert that into a hex number, and you get 8246, is that what you'd get if you convert that into hex? Anybody? You're not math people, are we? But now we see something different. Now the component O2 and the component 4-2 are pointing to different sensors, different upstream oxygen sensors. So when you look at all them SIDs that were on the previous page, you go, uh-huh, that's front sensors, rear sensors, left sensors, right sensors. Got sensors all over this car. So when you look at these, you have a, on your scan tool, a 0-2, you're going to be working on bank 1, sensor 1. If you had the 42, bank 2, sensor 1. And that's the important of the description. Now the PCM identifies the lean to rich threshold voltage. The result of this test will be used with other O2 sensor tests. Now here is a, this is why I put this up as an example, because on some of these TIDs and SIDs, there is physically nothing to do. I'm sorry, I got distracted with thumping. You know, yo, dude. Yeah, you gotta react to your customers, you know. Yo, man, you work on cars. So this test is used with other oxygen sensor tests. There's no physical thing that you can go do, because in this case, we don't know exactly what other test it wants to go to. We don't know if it's two different tests. If it fails this particular test, it goes to one test. If it fails this particular test, it goes to another test. But I have a light on, or I have a problem with a car. I have to fix that. And this is what I'm dealing with, a 0502 or a 42. And this is the only thing I see on the car. So I have to think what's going on. Now, this oxygen sensor waveform that you see there, I made in 1986 or something, 89. It was a brand new 89 Toyota when I first started doing these oxygen sensor waveforms. Anybody in here ever have rapid start diagnostics? Yeah, I mean, that is, you probably saw that. That's that running Toyota in that video. And this is the most perfect, flawless oxygen sensor waveform that I've ever gotten. They all don't look like this. I mean, this is like going from 2 to 8 tenths. I mean, it's just a flawless oxygen sensor. But there was like 400 miles on this toy when we were looking at it. Now, what I'm saying is, when we graft 1 second and we graft this, and we look at this oxygen sensor voltage switching to rich to lean to rich to lean, that's the standard right there. That's what I always use. Now, everything other than that, there's something different about. There's something wrong with, but there's a lot of things you can see in an oxygen sensor that you will chase you to a part, but there's a lot of things you can see in an oxygen sensor that you just have to let go. It's an anomaly, and you would spend too much of the customer's money trying to find out what's wrong with that car. So here's a vehicle that with an oxygen sensor that looks squirrely. It doesn't look perfect like our standard. I don't like this. I'm going to move this. What's going to happen is I'm going to trip over it, and then you're going to get a good laugh. But you know, when we're looking at the oxygen, say you pinned out this oxygen sensor, you put your scope on, and you say, I'm going to look at the oxygen sensor and look like this. I see a lot of things in that oxygen sensor waveform. Not a lot, but I see a few things. But remember what we're working on, 0542 or 02, and it's a lean to rich switch. Doesn't that lean to rich switch there look good? To me, it does. But this one doesn't. It tried to switch to rich, then it tried to switch to rich, and it finally made it. And here, we have a problem switching rich to lean. We have just the opposite problem. When you look at that oxygen sensor, does anything jump out at you? There's one thing that actually jumps out at me. Huh? Is it spiking to voltage? This one? And you know what those are? Those are ignition misfires. Those are ignition misfires. Those are cylinder misfires right there. The cylinder got so lean, that's what happened there. Took us from about 86 to 90. I think we released Rapid Start in 91. And we did a lot of research prior to releasing that video. And we found that these are basically ignition misses. That's what they are. All right. But anything else? I mean, it really looks different than the last one. The one thing that jumps out at me is fuel control. I mean, it really does. If I was looking at this, I'd say, wow, we got good fuel control, good oxygen sensor. Next thing to test, put it up in front of me, because I don't think I have an oxygen sensor problem, and I don't think I have a fuel control problem. But when I see this one, I honestly say, is that fuel control? Or is that an El Funko oxygen? I am bilingual. El Funko oxygen sensor. Is that oxygen sensor screwed up? I mean, right now, if this is all I ever did, I wouldn't know that. I can't tell you from this oxygen sensor. But I don't see any EGR leak in there. I don't, you know, I would say it's either a bad oxygen sensor or it's bad fuel control. When I see this here, this switch here, and I go, well, I don't know, the oxygen sensor tends to go rich when it's called rich, tends to go lean when it's called lean. I would lean toward fuel control on that oxygen sensor. This one here is a snap. I whacked the throttle and the oxygen sensor voltage went straight up. I mean, that's flawless right there. That's flawless. And that, I mean, just look at the graticule going up the side and then look at the trace. That is an excellent, excellent oxygen sensor. When I whack this throttle, it's certainly fast enough and amplitude is high enough. Its lean to rich is what? Excellent. That means you got the fuel to do it, right? And it means the oxygen sensor does it. Now, if you have a code, a failed monitor that turned the light on that said your lean to rich is bad, what could you possibly do? I mean, it doesn't get any better, trust me. I don't even have a PDA anymore. These PDA screens are just from a years and years ago. They are so flawless that I like to use them a lot. I like to use them. But what would you do? How could you satisfy that monitor? And a hush falls over the crowd, and it's so... But I got all the fuel in the world here. It's the same thing that I just kind of analogized with the catalytic converter. I tested it. I didn't find a darn thing wrong with it. But the monitor didn't like it. And that is something... Wait a minute. The monitors must be really good testers, because the EPA says they're better than IM240 testing. Right? I mean, isn't that what nobody disagreed with the EPA. Wouldn't want to do that. I think you get a fine for disagreeing with them. Some guy in a ponytail with sandals comes out and finds you or something. You know, I always cut down a tree on Arbor Day. I just... sort of rebellious, you know. In the old days, when I was an environmental terrorist, I'd cut V-belts off air pumps, you know, but you don't even have them anymore, so I have to cut down a tree on Arbor Day. Just works for me. But yeah, there's times when you're dealing with... Now here's... Let's just say this is not bad. What I'm telling you right now isn't a bad thing. It's a good thing. You have a result and you actually have a way to fix the result. The monitor doesn't like the lean-to-rich switch. You do. You do. You're going, holy cow, it doesn't get any gooder than that. That's good. That's good. And you go, what do I do now? Well, you can only replace the sensor. And because you know you got fuel. You got fuel to do this. And the oxygen sensor did it. And doggone it, now you have something you can make that light go out with, because you used mode 6. It told you that it didn't like part of the oxygen sensor. Didn't tell you it didn't like the whole thing. Didn't talk about amplitude or any resistance or anything. It just said, I don't like that switch. And you go, okay, the switch is good. You go, why? Replace it. Yes, sir?
You're only testing it at one moment in time.
And that's right, too. You're only testing it one moment in time, and they're only testing it for a tenth of a second. You know, the oxygen sensor here in this particular test, the monitor actually runs for a tenth of a second. How would I like to catch that monitor? How long is that test drive, right? Waiting for that one to click. Mrs. Jones, this is Billy Bob. Did you make a payment on that car? Because we still got it. Okay. Yep. Now look at this lean to rich. Now this is a different story here. This is a different story. That is bad. That is bad. And that's a horror. Look how much time it took to go from lean to rich. And then it kind of snuck around and went richer. Now you go, okay, now I got more testing to do before I replace that oxygen sensor. Now you got a failed, same failed 0502 or 42 for the other bank. And you say, yeah, but now it's cool because I can do more testing. Maybe you don't do that. You go, damn, where's the part? What part do I change? But right now, I don't know if I can change a part. The oxygen sensor didn't go straight up like it's supposed to. So I say to myself, did I get enough fuel? Do I have a fuel problem? Because now I want to look at fuel long before I dump in that oxygen sensor. How would you do that? Divide it. Remember what diagnostics is. I've been here two times and I always say the same thing. Diagnostic, I want to do something to divide the whole problem in half. I don't want to start at the beginning or the end and work all the way back or all the way forward. My first step, I like to cut it in half and know which way to turn, left or right. That's what I like to do. I just cut. So how can I cut this in half? Artificially enriching the engine. Artificially put carburetor cleaner in the engine. Or you know, ether. I don't care. No, I don't use no ether. I have a farm and we use ether on everything, you know, and then one time I put it in my car, and because I go, well, what the heck was I thinking, you know? I used to yell at people when they do, God, I don't like that speaker behind. It's like me standing behind me. That did sound weird, didn't it? But right here, I'd artificially enrich in a car. I actually use propane, and if that oxygen sensor shot straight up, I've divided the problem in half. With artificial enrichment, the oxygen sensor shoots straight up, so I know what? It's a good oxygen sensor. Now I gotta go fix the fuel problem. So you can see the difference here. Any questions, complaints about that?
Just on that the previous one where you had the lean to rich where it was a good switch and you said, well, you're only sampling it for 1 second. Could that even be a PCM reprogramming? Or where they're gonna change the monitor?
I will tell you that, yes, and I'm not trying to talk J2534 or factory scan tool, Anello programming. With OBD2 cars, I look up technical bulletins every day. I want to know, can I fix this? Can I put this part on and then need a monitor flash, need a flash anyway? I do that all the time, and we were buying other people's technical. Now we just go on a manufacturer website, pay the $10 or whatever, and look up those technical bulletins, because I don't know when it was when I got interested in flashing 2 years ago or something, but it just seemed like we'd work. It would be the last thing we do. We got two new parts on the dang car, and we're still screwing with it. And then somebody goes, well, did you look at a technical bulletin? And then it had a flash to fix the monitor or something. I go, whoops. You're lucky it was in here, Mrs. Jones. Why? Well, you had two bad parts and a reflash. Like the time we broke a car, and we said, boy, are you lucky it was in here. Why? Now you don't have to pay for a tow.
Save money.
Saving money right from the get-go, Mrs. Jones. She goes, really? Yeah, that was a good thing. I go, yeah, you're right. But it's just too slow there. Low aptitude. It's too slow. It's low aptitude. It's any way you look at it. Just El Funko. And that's one that's just begging to have propane puffed in on it. A lot of people squirt in carburetor cleaner, whatever. Whatever you're going to do. You know, your method. So descriptions are needed with the diagnostics and this result thing. You know, failed, what part of the test? Like I said, that's the first thing I look at. And I always look at the max and min and compare it to the value because I want to know how close it's failed. Because sometimes with you're putting all these modes together, you're looking at PIDs, you're looking at DTCs, you're looking at pending DTCs, history, and I mean, you're just looking at all this stuff, and you're trying to, and mode six, and you're trying to gather up some information because it's one of the hard ones. It's one of the hard ones. So you look up here and you say, well, some, and I love it when they say, well, sometimes the light's on. You know, what's that mean to me? That means it's going to come in and the light's not going to be on. I'll guarantee you, I don't know why. That we have like the fence that you have to drive to get into our place, I think it turns the lights off. You know, I called the fence guy, but he's insisted it doesn't. You know, I'm telling you, something happens there. But when you're looking at max and mins, and you're going to compare the value to it, it falls right into a category that I've always thought was important with diagnostic mode number one, PIDs. When you're looking at your scan tool and you're looking at PIDs, you're supposed to be studying them, not looking at them. And one thing that you should be doing is comparing it to specifications. And one thing you really want to compare to is you say, how close is it to the maximum spec or the minimum spec? Not just, you know, to me, if somebody says it's supposed to be 1 to 3, the dang thing better be 2. That's what that means to me. Because 2 means what? It ain't broke. It ain't going to slip into broke and slip out of broke. And I like that. But it's supposed to be 1 to 2 and it's 1.01. You make up swear words when you study. I made up so many words in my life. What the? So if the scan tool gives you the script, use it. If it's not, look it up. And if you don't have anything in your shop to look it up, you need to, what are you going to do on those mode 6 discs? You're going to bid on them? What do you say? I G talks, I don't listen. How can they win one of them? What do they got to do?
I'll have to rethink.
This could be a long time. G's going to think. But, I mean, get one. For gosh sakes, get one. Because they have all the TIDs and SIDs that you need for J1850. All right? And the Ford one has TIDs, MIDs and TIDs for CAN. But the rest of them are for J1850. But you're trying to glean information from all this information. And whatever they say or whatever their range of values are, you know, whatever the description is, here's a basic description. Here's telling you what the test is. Here's your voltages. And right here, I'm going, I cross that out right there. Remember, we're on a GM here. You know, the number one thing that I think I see on GM oxygen, and remember what I do for a living. I do what John Anello does. And I don't do it for a living, but I mean, I do it for research purposes. So the car's already been, I was going to say screwed with, but it was worked on. Screwed with. You know. And the number one thing I think I see on GM oxygen sensors is negative voltage. It seems like the techs always miss when they go into negative voltage. And negative voltage will screw up a car intermittently like you've never seen it before on a GM. And I know you guys see this, but, you know, because you take the time to look at it on a scope and your scan tool won't read negative voltage, you know. So it's, how many people are looking at oxygen sensors with scopes? It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. Absolutely beautiful. So who better to help you than this OBD2 guy, this computer guy? I mean, he's going to do tests. He's going to do precise testing. And you know what he's going to do? He's going to use the precise specifications. And he's going to do the test the same way every time. I'd like to say I could do that. You know, I kind of like, what mood am I in? Yeah, I'm going to go test that ignition. What mood am I in? You know, what I'm going to go test fuel system on that car. What mood am I in? You know, I mean, where's the Schrader? It doesn't have a Schrader valve. Ah, fuel pressure's okay. Right? Why are you laughing? You've done that. Yeah, now the first thing you're supposed to be checking is the last thing you're checking. You know, it can't be fuel pressure. Why? Because I can't test it. Well, not easily. But just remember, it may be smarter than you, and it's doing little things here and there. It's going to use a monitor. It's going to say, hey, I use this monitor for other testing. And that means to you, you probably shouldn't be changing a part. That's what that means. Probably should be looking at fuel control, ignition control, EGR, EVAP. You know, I can't remember the last one I had, but just the other day, a guy calls me, idle's funny, blah, 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 blah. Done everything, and I go, just disconnect, purge. Because he gave me his laundry list of everything. He goes, what? So did you disconnect purge? Pinch it off, see if the problem goes away. He's never called me back, you know. And I'm going, God, I haven't had one of those in a long time. You know, you just don't see saturated canisters like we did back in the 80s and the 90s, you know. But it still happens, you know. So mode 6 is the latest monitor. It's the last monitor. It doesn't mean it's happened yesterday. It doesn't mean it happened today. It means it's the last time it tested. So when you're thinking about that, you're going, okay, the last monitor. That could actually be when the light came on 3 days ago before you got it, you know. So I showed you, sometimes I just can't get a good Genesis photograph here for different reasons, shop conditions. Sometimes I'm out in the sunlight, sometimes out in the rain, light. You know, I'll work on a car wherever I can get it. And I'll redraw those those bad photographs for you. So as we go through these TIDs and SIDs and these actual parts of monitors and components, this is the one thing I had to do in order to understand the descriptions, is slow down, read it over and over and over and over again, study the data involved. So what I did was went past the description. What I did was went past the description, because when I first started using descriptions, you know, the scan tool points to the oxygen sensor. I'm on the oxygen sensor like stink on poo, right? I mean, why wouldn't I be? When it points to the cat, I'm on the cat. When it points to EVAP, I'm on EVAP. The one thing about GM and EVAP is it's kind of friendly. I mean, it's kind of user-friendly. You know, they have a purge test, a purge valve test. And why do you have to check for a leak if it's a purge valve? You know, if it's going to point to something, hey, take advantage of that individual component it's pointing to. So when I was using descriptions, I found I was replacing components that did not need to be replaced. Anybody in here ever put a part on a car and found out it didn't need it? Okay. Anybody in here lying? Because I didn't see that many ads. You know, I go, God, I just can't believe I've done it. I actually did it 2 weeks ago. So I was so dang sure. You know, you get so sure. You get, yeah. And then you fall into a Ford P0171. You know it's a dirty mass airflow. Before you do any testing, you clean it, now it's still there, now you go, oh God, I touched a car before I tested it. Whoa. What was I thinking? So let's work with some Ford Mode 6 here. I think, I didn't put much Ford in here because I think that if you've been to any Mode 6 class, you've seen a lot of Ford. So we're just going to look down the list and pick one, and then when we pick a 21, we go, or 41 rather, you go, okay, here's 41. Oh, look, got certain model years, then turns into a 42, and then a 43 actually turns into a DPFE. Oh, so they're all DPFE. This is a pressure, okay, this is a monitor, they're calling it. This is a pressure test. This is stuck open EGR valve. Now, when you get a Ford, no flow, low flow, too much flow, what do you think the problem is 90% of the time? Yeah, DPFE, delta pressure feedback EGR valve position sensor, right? Yeah, and that's true. I mean, that's true, because when I get a code, they pull it up, I put my hand back on it, raise idle it, pump the EGR up, and if the engine doesn't go down, I go, okay, I got a bad EGR valve, but if it goes down, I go, I got a bad delta PFE, then I put in a scan tool and do the same thing, and I say, yep, I didn't expect the voltage to move. But no, those DPFEs, they go back, 100 maybe replaced? What would you say, 100 in your shop? I mean, they're just always. It's one of those things you go, I know what's wrong, but if I don't test and put one in, it's going to catch me, right? So we'll jump on a SID here, and then you'll see that you always have to convert Ford. And there's times when I don't convert Ford. I use the raw data as a max and min. And you know, I've never actually been caught in trouble doing that. Anybody do that, not convert them and just convert the numbers and they just use the raw data? You all really go through and convert? Oh, you do? You're smart like me. But no, you're lazy like me. No, you don't know math like me. But I don't always convert that data. But you know, when you look at 42 and 49, it has a conversion factor. Subtract a number, then multiply a number to get inches of water. Here's your example. This would be your number on your scan tool. Subtract this number, multiply by this number, and you get 5.9 inches of water. And when you look at your scan tool data, you say, okay, this converts to 5.9, this converts to minus 7, this converts to 7. Okay, my 5.9 is a pass, all right? Uh-oh, was that a pass if you didn't convert them? Is this number bigger than this number? Yeah. Oh my God. Boy, look at that. The max is smaller than the min. Yeah, if you don't convert them, it's like spitting in the wind. It's just like going to come right back on you. You're going to look foolish, you know. So what happens here is we have charts in those discs that you want to get when G thinks about how you can get them. But we have charts, or you can do the math. It really doesn't matter. Convert it, use a chart, use a hexadecimal value, you know, use pass fail, whatever thing that works in your shop. I will tell you, I don't convert every Ford, but when I see one confusing like this, I'll convert that problem. So let's look at these. We grab a 01, 02 oxygen sensor. Now, if we're working with a SID 11, we're looking at amplitude test. And there's your conversion factors this time. There's no subtraction in this one, I don't think. Nope, there's no subtraction in this one. And what you're just going to do some simple conversion here. And you can see that the calculator in the background is the one on your desktop. Everybody got a computer in your shop? Just go ahead and use that desktop. You know, and if you don't know how to do that, I can show you at break time because somebody showed me. So right here, we have an oxygen sensor on a scope. It points to oxygen sensor amplitude. I'm going to be dealing with amplitude. Now, the description did not say it was too high, the amplitude. It didn't say it was too low. It just said, hey, it's an amplitude test. So oxygen sensors are tested for this amplitude and switching, and there's our rich, and there's our lean, and there's our stoke. So it's actually a functionality test in Ford. They're going to test how well this oxygen sensor works. Now here's the caveat to a monitor at OBD2. Remember I told him he was smarter than you sometimes. This PCM is going to run by this monitor by placing the fuel control in a special function, but they're going to test it. Now here's something that when you're talking about this mode 6 stuff, I find this very interesting because this is going to be a test which you cannot duplicate. Sure, we can whack the throttle. We can pump in artificial fuel. You know, we can artificially enrich this, but you know what? I know for a fact, I drive Fords, and I drive Fords that have this monitor, and I know when this monitor runs, it's not intrusive. I do not feel this vehicle accelerate. You know, I mean, if they're going to add fuel to see the amplitude change, you know what? You add fuel to an engine, doesn't it go faster? That's pretty much the way they work in the Midwest. I don't know how they work out here. In the South, they put in a little moonshine. No? But it's a non-intrusive test. So the amount of fuel they must be adding in this special test must be so minuscule that I'm not going to be able to duplicate that. Now that's good, but right here, this is a good thing. And maybe I am optimistic and I'm always looking at things the good side of it. But what I'm saying now is, wow, this is going to test an oxygen sensor better than I can test it. God, I got a partner here. It's a little box. I don't know what's its name? Fred. But yeah, Fred, that's a good name. I mean, I've heard that acronym before, you know, differently. You know. But I'm going, holy cow, here, we got to test an oxygen sensor. We got to test an oxygen, me and Fred. Now, I can fall in the habit of believing them every time. I can fall in the habit of believing that and just replacing parts. But I have replaced parts that didn't need to be replaced before. And I'm not going to fall for that, so I am going to do some testing. But you know what? Don't you walk across the shop and say, Dave, what do you think? Dave goes, I guess. Yeah? Or you call somebody, Identifix, like a great phone call. What do you think? Then they read something to you, you know. And they are the best. Don't get me wrong. Anybody in here use Identifix? They are really, really good. It just, they're sometimes reading out of the book that I have. <That's>, yeah.
Find the page.
Yeah. Am I paying you to find that page? But here I have a partner in this crime that I'm going to commit. I'm going to replace a part. You know, almost all fixes, except now they have 5.5 miles of wire on a car. Isn't that what he said? Did you guys listen to him? You know, 5.5 miles of wire on a car. And we have less. I see less wiring problems than I did in the 80s. The 80s were nightmarish. And I think it was Packard Electric made those harnesses, Dave? Huh? They still do. They got better at it, right?
Found out in Mexico.
But you know, I mean, we find a lot less. But here I have a partner in crime. Now, here's what we're talking about. And I just drew this stuff for you here. Here's one that... The time is nothing. Here's one, the time's a little longer. It's going from 0 to 0.5 volt. It's nothing. It's a little bit longer. It's nothing. It's a little bit longer. Here's one, the really long one. That's an obvious one. To get to 5 volts took a long time. So that's what this test is testing here. And when you test drives the air fuel rich mixture near Stoltz, now I can't do that. See, I can whack the throttle, I can add propane. But I can't catch it down here and add so much, so little that I just drive it near Stoke. You saw what it goes when I add a little propane. It goes straight up, shoots right past. So what happens, it's a special fuel control routine. The monitor measures the oxygen sensor rise in voltage for 1/10 of a second. Now, I can't do that. But before I replace that oxygen sensor, it's getting scoped. It's going to get scoped, all right? Because what we talked about in the last oxygen sensor waveforms, do I think it could be fuel control? Do I not think it could be fuel control? Divide it in half. Once you're positive, that this monitor didn't fail because of bad fuel control, and the and Fred, how can I keep forgetting the name? And Fred doesn't like the oxygen sensor. You can change it with a lot of confidence. You know, we have three type of people who change parts. The religious kind, I pray that takes care of it. You know, the optimist, boy, I hope that takes care of it. And the confused, I wonder if that'll take care of it. But you could actually go, that'll take care of it. Because I'm sure that it's not fuel control. I'm absolutely, positively sure fuel control is where, we'll go over fuel control one time. We're not going to do it on every oxygen sensor, TID, SID. But we can go over it one time, you know. But what you know now is divide it in half. When we're just talking about oxygen, we didn't even get to EVAPs yet. We're talking about oxygen sensors. Divide it in half. You say, hey, Fred doesn't like the oxygen sensor. But the oxygen sensor can't work good without good fuel control. So divide it. So another thing is when you keep reading in these descriptions, you got to look on this TID and SID, you got to look at long-term fuel trim, because long-term fuel trim plays an important part. Long-term fuel trim must be within plus or minus or 25, because you're going to get a false fail out here. Now, there you go. Connecting a scan tool, getting data up, pretty easy thing to do. Unless you're fat and you can't find a diagnostic connector, but, you know, I have a knee pad that I use to find diagnostic connectors, you know. Throw the pad down and kneel down and get it connected, and I stand up and leave my knee pad down there all the time. I got to go down a second time to get it. But I tell you, as old and tired and lazy as I am, connecting a scan tool is pretty easy. So I can look up here. I'm working with this TID 42, and I go, hey, you know what? TID 42 means nothing. It does nothing. It means nothing, because that test is so old, it means nothing. It has a caveat. Long-term fuel trim is not where it's supposed to be, and if it's not where it's supposed to be, that test can't run normally, and if it can't run normally, it means nothing to me. Now that's good information. I don't care what you say. You go, aha, I'm on fuel control like stink on poo. Right? And when you think about it, you go, wow, if I would have looked at long-term fuel trim, I'd have been on fuel trim stink on poo too. But you know what? Sometimes we go into mode 6 and we get distracted by other things. But when you read these descriptions, you go, okay, this one really ties into long-term fuel trim. So beware of those false failures. Long-term fuel trim, if it is within 25, there's your oxygen sensor. Now, does that look good? Doesn't look perfect like that standard I show you, but does that look good? This means yes, this means no, this means break time. All right? Little response. But this is more of what you see with noise, you know, and rattling around there. And I will tell you right now what you care about when you see this. You can look at this and go, oh, 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 don't mean nothing. It's one time out of 100. It's an anomaly. I don't know what went wrong there, but you ain't going to find it. You know, I don't think John could find it. And he told me he was the best out of you guys. And it's the same thing with all these little anomalies. So what you're looking for is a repetitive problem. Something that's repetitive. For example, now I'm going to draw with a stupid hand. I'm sure you can see this in the back, so I'll make it big. When you see bumps like this, and it's repetitive, almost on every rich switch, It's a leaking EGR. Go to the bank on it, because it is a leaking EGR. Who did that?
It's me. Him again.
I think when I was writing, I was squeezing it. So I'll give you a pass on this one. All right. But, you know, there's some anomalies that when they repeat and they repeat and they repeat, it's like if there was that spike in there, that spike in there, and that spike in there. Hey, you got an ignition miss. Go test the ignition. And I don't care if the spike's going up or down. That spike, if you think about a scope going across this time, and that spike is straight up, straight down, it can be nothing but electrical. It can't be fuel because fuel don't react that fast. You know, hopefully, because if, you know, maybe if the engine blew up, it'd be one big spike. But you could tell by the soot on you and the smell of burning flesh. So yeah, when there's some repetitive things. Now this look, I mean, this here is, you go, oh, look at that, but it's not perfect, but that's a great sensor there. That's great fuel control there. I mean, that's really good, even with all the little problems in there. Here's no fuel control. I mean, here's absolutely no fuel control. You go, oh my goodness. That, you know, you can see little bumps there, but that's not fuel control. You know, here you'd want to test the oxygen sensor. You would want to artificially propane this pupper. And I know you don't use propane, but I just think it's the best way to do it. I think it's the best way to look for vacuum leaks. So you squirt all you want, you know, do what you want. But I just think propane works better. And we have it because we have a barbecue. We're so far from any place to go get lunch that we just, hey, barbecue time. Can't work on your car today, lady. We're barbecuing ribs. But here, is it the sensor's not responding to a computer doing fuel control? You know? And I have two words or two descriptions I made up. You won't see them any. I mean, this. I have two descriptions that I use, fuel control and fuel management. And it's just in my head I made them up. It's nothing that I read anywhere. Fuel control to me is when the throttle is not moving. Fuel control to me is when the throttle's not moving. The computer's trying to get it go rich, lean, rich, lean, rich, lean, and trying to happy make happy stoach. Now, fuel management to me is when you move the throttle, you're opening it. Fuel management increases fuel. When you close the throttle, it should decrease the fuel. And that's why I wired my injectors to my radar detector and my ABS.
And the ABS.
Haven't had a ticket in a long time. Lost some teeth. Now here's poor fuel control. Everybody's trying. And this kind of, you know, kind of looks like it's been a long time rich, but when you look at your gain over here, you go, well, there's my one. Oh, look at that. It wasn't really rich. You know, pay attention to your voltage here. You go, yeah, I was on the rich side of 0.5, but here, you know, 0.5, but it wasn't very rich. So this tells me the car's running lean in it, and even though the somebody's saying try to go rich, it's never making it. It's never making it. An oxygen sensor like this tells me go test fuel control, fuel delivery, fuel volume, cavitation. You know, do you see a lot of pumps that cavitate fuel? No, I guess that's the wrong question. Well, I don't think we see a lot. They always catch us by the short hairs. You know, it's one of the last things we check for, cavitation. It's so hard to check. You got to open that petcock and look at that hose. You don't see cavitating fuel pumps? Bubbles and,
Chrysler.
And
the sock gets restricted and the modules empty up.
Yeah, we see a lot of Fords and it's hilarious. We see a lot of Fords. Now, so test the speed of the sensor by snapping the throttle. Now, does that look good? I snapped the throttle here. Here's three snaps in a row. Boom, boom, boom. It was actually four, but three clean ones on there. Three clean ones on there. And look at the repetitive good. I mean, when I talk about repetitive bad, repetitive good is, you know, these all look the same. And you go, wow, that looks pretty cool. That's, wow, that looks really cool. But look at this. Look at this. Look how straight those are. And then look at this one. So when you're going to look at the speed of it, if you have any questions, use a cursor. Use a cursor, because the cursor goes straight up and down. It's a vertical line on a scope. You use the cursor, and to me, this, I may let this pass if it kept rising here, but something happened here. We either ran out of fuel or we ran out of sensor. We ran out of fuel, we ran out of sensor. This one begs for artificial enrichment. It begs, say, hey, give me a shot, baby, and I'll tell you what I can do. Now I'll look at how do you feel, good or bad. Yeah, see? It didn't look that bad when it was there, but when you do enough of them, you go, oh, I know what good is. Now I know what bad is. Because it starts out here, and it very rarely ever rises up exactly. Pretty bad. All right, if the sensor doesn't perform with an improved, faster snap, and that's what I do long before I grab the propane bottle. I'll snap it, and the oxygen sensor doesn't look that good. I give it a longer, faster snap. I mean, I whack it. Very cautious about going to WFO, but really what I meant was wide open. That just happens to be a Midwest term we use, you know. But so I'll whack it harder and faster. And I may do it three times, and I can't say I haven't done it four times. I really want to see it. And sometimes when an oxygen sensor won't go all the way up to 0.9 volts on a snap, I'll whack it a couple times trying to get it to go. I'm trying to tickle the oxygen sensor. It's called reaction-reaction testing. It works like this. If I walk over and stomp on your foot and you yell, my head hurts, I know something's wrong. I know something's wrong. All right. If the sensor does improve with a longer, faster snap, then go ahead and check fuel delivery, fuel volume. Now, Bernie scope, the AE, this does not work on a Genesis very well. This does not work on a Genesis very well. I have been, and basically it's the E-scan that I started grafting oxygen sensors with and snapping the throttle. I don't know why they look better than OTC. I don't know. But if you know, this saves you from finding an oxygen sensor and getting your scope set up, getting an extension, you know, I mean, it saves a lot of time if you can use scan data grafting. Now, this particular one, I believe, is on an auto ingenuity. All right? And I have come to a custom. I actually stopped using the AE. I use the e-scan more every day now. But those scans seem to work well, and they seem to not lie to me about the speed of an oxygen sensor. Not actually just where the OTC, you whack the throttle, you wait 2 to 3 seconds, and then it shoots straight up. I can't identify that. I mean, that just bothers me tremendously. But these, if you want to try it on your scan tool, and then if it looks slow or funky, then go do the scan, the DSO test. Questions on it? All right. So we can always go to a different one. Here we're going to heaters now, and heaters are kind of interesting because, as much as I did in the beginning, like looking at catalytic converters on mode 6, oxygen sensor heaters really help in mode 6 because there's only one thing I thought I could do on oxygen sensor heaters, and that was to measure current. Well, what happens is when then you get to a Chrysler that has pulse width heaters, and it just screws you all up. So here we're still on GM, and we're going to actually look at the ohms, and I would never look at the ohms of an oxygen sensor, never in a million years. But here's the SIDS, oxygen sensor heater resistance monitor. Here's your range of values. I'm not going to ohm. You know, maybe I've told you before, using an ohm meter is like measuring with a micrometer, marking it with a piece of chalk and cutting it with a hatchet. Somewhere in the process, you're going to lose something. An ohm meter is a logarithmic measuring device, and in the automotive business, we try to make linear measurements with it. It's just, you know, and I actually know some instructors that say you shouldn't even have an ohm meter in your shop. I don't go that far, because there is times I use it. But I will tell you that, you know, it just doesn't tell you about load. Just doesn't tell you, can this carry a load or not? So, and I'm sure Dave over there is thinking, what? The ohm meter's a great tool, you know, but he works on minuscule amperage, you know. PCM uses heater current and system voltage to calculate the resistance. Look at this. Boom. Now we have pulse width GM. Measuring heater current will show if they're working normally. Warm engine heater activity. Now the reason this is here, warm engine heater activity, is because this engine is warm. When it's cold, you get a little more current and you get a lot more of these. Now, is this heater working? Yes. Take a look at that. This GM heater is working. It's pulling at the ground. It's working. All right? It's not like a Chrysler, JTEC. Well, you know what? I'll talk about JTEC individually. JTEC, you can actually measure the heaters without ever starting the engine if you wanted to. So here you're going to put your low current probe around the oxygen sensor heater. Normal for a hot restart right here. This heater is working. Heater off, heater on. Hey, this is working fine. This oxygen sensor heater. Now on a cold startup, you're going to get a lot more of these. A lot more of them. Many more of them. How many? Don't have a standard. Don't have a specification. Questions? All right. So right here, that's not. Actually, it should see current there. All right. We have check fuse, no current, check fuse, right there. There's your fuse. Now, this is, GM has a fuel systems, I think it's the 3.3 or the 3.1, I don't remember which one it is, but the oxygen sensor heater, or the oxygen sensor voltage comes off the mass airflow sensor. The oxygen sensor voltage comes off for the heater, come off the mass air. I don't know if it's a 3.1, but it'll screw you all up because You look in mode 6 and you failed the heater monitor and you'll still have a drivability problem, and the drivability problem is relating to the mass airflow. And I wish I could remember which one that is. I've only had one or two of those, but it's a 3, you know what, it could be the 3.4, I don't know. You'll find out when you look in the schematic. You have just remember, if you have a mass airflow question and heater questions, Go find the wiring diagram and get it all pumped up there. Questions? If you have no ground pulse, go check the grounds. And you know, George S. Ohms probably said it best: current in electrical circuits directly proportional to the voltage applied, and indirectly proportional to the resistance of the circuit. And I always say it differently. I say if you can't get voltage high enough, go check power. If you can't get voltage low enough, go check ground. And I mean, this is the way I think. If you got too low a power, go check power. If you got too high a ground, go check ground. Grounds are supposed to be low. Could be like when I was at OTC, they told me grounds are always zero. Never knew that. Never actually knew that. I said, you know what? I don't think I've ever seen one that was zero. So here's a Chrysler spec. We're changing manufacturers now, not to be bored with GM. Now here's a 1B80, Sid, and this is a pre-catalyst oxygen sensor. It's the delta, or the change, delta, or the change in voltage. Now here's something that we got to take time to talk about in Chrysler, because they only have a few SIDs. Their SIDs are 80, 0, 0, 0, 1, or FF. That's the only SIDS they have. They don't have a whole list of component IDs. And when you get an 80, that means this test is looking for a minimum value. When you get a 00 or a 01, it's looking for a maximum. Now, I can't tell you why they have two of these. I can only tell you that on some scan tools, 00 means max, and on other scan tools, 01 means max. So I don't know if it's a scan tool thing or it's a Chrysler thing. And FF, if you get a SID FF, it just means the test didn't run. Questions on this. These are the SIDs that you're going to be dealing with in Chrysler. There are no endless number. All right, so you can see that 1B80 indicates that we're going to be looking at a minimum limit. That actually means nothing, but it's not an endless list. This is the right oxygen sensor when DO2s are used for fuel control. The PCM monitors O2 voltage with the engine running. There you have it. What are we doing, guys? I would hope you'd say, damn, we're doing the same thing. We're doing the same thing. We're going to test O2 sensors. I mean, what else would you do when you're looking for a minimum? Oh, wow. Minimum. Wow. Oh, wait a minute. It's a new caveat to O2 sensor testing. Chrysler's doing something with a minimum. When we're talking about O2 voltage, what is minimum? Yeah, numbers-wise, but it's lean, right? We're dealing with the lean side of fuel control here. We're dealing with the lean side. Now, we haven't mentioned this up to now, but when you're dealing with the lean side of fuel control, you got to add a vacuum leak, don't you? You got to add a vacuum leak. Sure, you got fuel control problems that maybe you're not getting enough fuel, but a lean engine is too much air or not enough fuel. It's not brain surgery, you know. So when you read these descriptions, and I know I keep saying this, you got to glean information. You got to understand what it is they're looking for. Now, you can see we did a snap test. Now, look at this oxygen sensor here. Look at this oxygen sensor. We're in the green. I'm sorry, I stand in front and tell you to look at it. And I snap it. I mean, is that fast enough, that response time? Yeah. This is, what is that, 0.2? Yep. I'm kind of close here. That's 0.2, and is this 0.8, hopefully? Yep. Yeah. Now, look at that. And we say that commonly. We say oxygen sensors should kind of work between 0.2 and 0.8. I mean, look at that oxygen sensor. Now, when we whack it, short time, does it go? It flat topped because we have a 1 volt scale and it went off scale. That's why it did that. But right here, what did we do? We whacked the throttle and held it for a little while. Did it go rich and stay there? Now, look at this here. You got noise down on the lean side, but do you have it on the rich side? Yeah. Remember, we're kind of talking about the lean stuff here. Does it go lean? Yes. Does it stay lean? No, it didn't stay lean. Well, go rich and stay rich. Yeah, it's doing all those things. And so when you read these descriptions, and this, you can actually add the rear O2 if you want. Does the rear O2 go fast enough? Yeah. Does it go rich and stay there? Yeah. So it doesn't matter if you're working on the front or the rear. Now look at this here, this cycle here, when we're not doing nothing. Did we have a problem going lean here? Yeah, it didn't make it. Did we have a problem here? Where's two, right there? So we went lean here. That's the last time we went lean in this series. Wow, this kind of has a rich bias, doesn't it? Wow, we're talking about a monitor that looks at the lean side of the oxygen sensor. And we're talking about a sensor waveform here that stays rich. Do those two combine? Do those help you? How can we get a rich bias? There's only one way. Fuel. Fuel. Now think about this as a whole collective system, a whole entire car. Because we're going to do that in a minute. We're going to talk, see it as a whole car, the whole fuel control system as one. All right, so on domestics, you know, no matter how good the oxygen sensor is that you tested, if the monitor doesn't like it, you're going to have to replace it. All right, TID 1A, SID 80 after catalyst oxygen sensor. So this is an after cat sensor, B1 sensor 2, heated trend counter. Now this is another thing we don't know what the trend is. We don't know exactly how to measure trend. And of course with the limited SIDs, that means a minimum limit. This is the right side sensor when dual oxygen sensors are used for cat monitors. The PCM runs the monitor after 6 to 12 minutes after shutdown. You could watch this. I've done it in class when I used to teach Viper and Prowler, and I did some special classes for Chrysler. And you can put a lab scope on the oxygen sensor, and what happens is after 6 to 12 minutes after you shut the hot engine down, the computer starts pulsing 5 volts to the oxygen sensor, and you get a little voltage train on your lab scope. A lot of people call that stuff square waves, but that's a specialized term. So you actually get a voltage train, and it's pulsing 5 volts. Then they turn the heater on. And if you think about it, Chrysler's heater relay for their oxygen sensor was always the fuel pump relay. So they went, okay, we don't really want to turn the fuel pump on while the car's sitting there with no key in it. So they changed it to the ASD relay. So the ASD relay does wake up, and it starts pulsing at 5 volts to it. And when the heater comes on, it heats it up, and the voltage gets lower and lower and lower because of resistance change. Then it turns the heater off, and you can actually watch the voltage get higher and higher on it. I don't suggest it because it takes about 20 minutes to just to tell you that the heater is working. We measure the heater current because that's the bottom line. And what we're going to look at here is heater control in the green there. Now this is no ignition, and then we turn the ignition on, and then we get the heater control. It starts pulsing right away, and that's the heater control circuit. Here's the oxygen sensor circuit, and of course here's your heater circuit. And you can see that we get a current pulse right here. Builds up, boom, we got a certain amount of current there. So when we look at B plus for the oxygen sensor, we know that the oxygen sensor is getting its voltage for the current. And the heater current, 0 to 1 amp, we're happy with that. That's very common for Chrysler, 0 to 1 amp. Heater control pulses, this is normal. What we see here is it a pulse for a while, stop pulsing, pulse for a while. And look what happens to the current. It stops seeing the pulse, so it stops being driven to ground. This is very, very common. So when you look at this, the reason I'm telling you this is common is simply because you could go, well, why does the heater stop here? Remember, you're working on a TID and a SID that said, oh, something's wrong with the heater. So now you go, oh, I found it. What? You know, now you go into mechanic stance. What'd you find? I don't know what you found, you know. But that's normal, very common for this. After warming up, the PCM stops altogether, and current stays right just under 1 amp. So, I mean, that's what you just saw was a Chrysler start up and warm up, and that's exactly the way they work. They just do not start controlling them and continue to control them until they're hot. They'll pulse them for a while, stop. Pulse them for a while, stop. But is this heater working? Working fine, thank you. All right, and now we have a steady heater current. Everything's fine. Questions on Chrysler SBEC heaters. All right, ignition on. That's the key right there. You see, right now we know everything's working. We could actually just stop testing right there. You know, boom. The heater's getting its battery voltage. We're getting heater current. We're getting control. And actually, even if you didn't bother to use three channels, you know this is there. Why? Yeah, because your current's being toggled. So you know that's there. But I put it up there as a visual thing. G said you guys were kind of slow. And no, he didn't say that. So then that's when the engine starts up. Notice we just get one pulse until the engine starts. And then we got a good ground. We got good power. We got good current. Boom. Steady current. Questions on that? And I am speeding it up a little bit. I don't know if we'll ever get through everything, but so now we have a low current probe. We have three channels. We have the two voltage probes and low current probe. And I mean, is this heater working? Yeah. Yeah, I mean, questions on it. All right, Chrysler JTEC 19 and 00, pre-cat oxygen sensor, heater timed activity. And you know, this is the way I used to look at heaters for years. I used to, before I got into mode 6, I know for a fact that every OBD2 car's oxygen sensor will go and start switching within 2 minutes. The really, really good ones, no matter Ford, GM, Chrysler, they start real quick. They minute 15, minute 10, and the oxygen sensors switching. What happens when they're cold, they just lay there on the lab scope and then they start switching. And they don't switch real good right away. But then I say, hey, the heater's working. I know the heater's working. That's the way I used to do it. But now remember what I'm doing. I'm trying to satisfy a monitor. This is the right side sensor with dual. And the guys who won those discs, I mean, all this information is that all you got to do is put it in your computer and it's going to come up and a talking voice is going to tell you what to do. And then you just follow your TID and SID messages, your menus rather, not messages. And it'll drill down and tell you what the monitor, what the description is, what the long description is, what the and what to do, how it's being tested and what to do. So they're pretty good old discs. When there's a failure, you need to measure heater current. Now look at this on a JTEC. We get this big ASD relay. This is heater voltage. We get this big pulse. We got a big pulse on SBAC. And then look what happens in heater current here. Look at heater current here. What don't we see? Pulses. We don't see pulses. And I will tell you one thing, that JTEC and SBAC are two different cars. One of them's foreign. I just haven't figured out which one. You know what I mean? JTEC and SBAC, they may both be Chrysler. And then they fixed it, right? They went to NGC, next generation controller, right? We got a 2007 Dodge Ram truck. It's got a JTEC on it. It does not have a next generation controller on it. So, I mean, I don't know. I think the Germans are still mad at us about that war thing we kicked their rear end, you know? You ever see, you know how Daimler Chrysler says Daimler Chrysler? They say Daimler. But we get that ignition switch pulse, and then we get our, when we start the engine, we get that steady current, all right? Now, this tells us, this, I haven't seen a dozen of them actually hit 2 amps. Chrysler's spec is 2 amps. I haven't seen a half a dozen of them actually hit 2 amps. My number's somewhere around 1.5 or a little higher, and I'm happy with this JTEC heater. But remember, they got a brand new oxygen sensor in a brand new car, brand new truck, Jeep truck controller. And I'm looking at old beat up stuff that nobody wants anymore. So what happens here is the current settles down here at somewhere between 0.5 and 0.8 or so. And I'm real happy with that oxygen sensor on that JTEC. A special note on JTEC, and you probably know this, but I got to make sure you know this. On Jeep truck engine controllers from Chrysler, it's got a 5-volt pull-up on that oxygen sensor. It's got a 5-volt pull-up on this oxygen sensor. All right. So if you're on a generic scan tool, not enhanced, generic, you're getting OBD2 information, your scan tool is probably going to read 1 volt. Now, if you're on a Genesis and you're over in Global OBD2, you're probably going to see 1 volt on it. If you're in Chrysler specific, you're going to see 5 volts on that oxygen sensor key on when it's cold. Right? Okay. But a lot of people say, well, I don't see that. Well, you're working in generic all the time. You know, that's why. And it does make a difference when you start connecting lab scopes to these oxygen sensors, because you're going to, depending on the impedance of the lab scope, you're going to affect that circuit. All right, so you know, here's what we're used to. Here's JTAC, and you can see here, we're running right about 1.69. When we disconnect the lab scope, boom, we get high voltage. See that? So when you connect your lab scope, don't expect to see 5 volts on it. You know, Bernie, what's your impedance on yours? Okay, he's got 10 megs, so it's going to affect it a lot less than the Pico does, a lot less, all right? And actually, this is a Pico I'm using on this because I don't have Bernie's. You guys weren't supposed to do it. You're supposed to go, oh, work with me, guys, work with me here. Jesus, really. But you can see when we disconnect it, it just jumps up there. So when you start connecting stuff, you know, devices to measure to this, you're going to affect the circuit. And you heard about this in LA. Oh, you got to have 20 mega ohm DVOM and blah, 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 blah. You got to have all that. And they were right. We just didn't know why, and the salesman didn't know why, that we had to have them, but we had to have them because they affect the circuit. How many people check TPSs with an analog meter for years, watch the needle sweep and rattle around? Me neither. Nobody did that? Oh, thank you. But here's a, I think this is a German, oh, this is a Polish lab scope. No, scan tool, I meant to say. No, but you can see, it's generic. And when I first saw this, did I call you on the phone, Bernie? I said, ruh-roh. Because I plugged into Genesis, and it read 5 volts, and then I plugged in Bernie's. I should call it the E-scan, it's not the Bernie scan. Now, there's a name. And I said, oh, ruh-roh. And, you know, it's because one's in generic, and one's in specific there. So the oxygen sensor warming up. Look what happens when you just turn the key on. See the oxygen sensor voltage go down? You can tell this heater's working without ever starting this car and warming this engine. Now, you don't have any engine heat here. Is this one working? Remember I told you I'd show you on a JTAC? I just turned the key on and read it? Now, actually, I stole this test out of an Ease. Anybody using an Ease scan tool? I mean, they have that test is in your program or something, and they can do that. And I said, hey, but you can do it on a JTAC right here. Questions? After the engine is warmed and the sensor's working, it works within 0 to 1 volt, right? I mean, once it's working, that 5-volt pull-up doesn't play into the circuitry, and what happens is you got a 0 to 1 volt sensor. Questions on JTAC? Oxygen sensors. All right, here's a GM oxygen sensor, low voltage for switch time calculation. And then right here, the PCM identifies the low voltage point where fuel control changes direction to take the mixture in. Oh, okay, now let's see this. Identifies the low voltage point. Oh, this is a little bit different. We may not want to speed through this. It identifies these low points here. Now notice these are not repetitive. So it, I imagine if it was low several times in a row, it would fail the monitor. This is the point. I mean, right down here. You can see that this is where it's checking whether a test passes or fails. So when the voltage isn't normal, the test fails. Now, we don't have access to know what's normal. We know what we think is normal, right? Oxygen sensors work from 200 to 800 millivolts, 2/10 to 8/10, however you want to say it. And we think that's pretty normal. And even today, we think that's pretty normal. And with exponentially weighted moving averages and stuff, sometimes normal becomes a little bit ambiguous, especially on Chryslers and the way they do it. But we'll look at an oxygen sensor. And this is very important, so make sure I didn't put you to sleep with the last one. So when I look at an oxygen sensor, I can't tell if it's been affected by the exponentially moving average. I really can't. I mean, I understand it, understand the theory behind it, but I don't know if this oxygen sensor is affected by that part of the monitor. So I look at the oxygen sensor and I go, huh. And I want to know, yeah, it's moving. Yeah, it's fast enough, whack the dial. Now look at it overall. Let's just say instead of 2/10 to 8/10, it's moving 3/10 to 8.5/10. Do we have a rich bias? No. And vice versa for lean bias. So now you see a bias in it. It's the whole thing shifted down, the whole thing shifted up. You go, oh, I got a lean or a rich bias. Magic question here. What's the very next data bit you look at? Long-term fuel trim. Just remember the rules. Fuel delivery drives the oxygen sensors, which drive short-term, which drive long-term. So you jump right out to long-term and you say, huh, what's going on here? And then you say, wow, yes, I have a rich bias. No, I don't have a lean bias. Now you know something. Now you know the condition, and it's kind of a health check of the PCM. You say, hey, I have a rich bias. My whole pattern looks good. It's fast enough, but it's higher than normal. Doesn't go to 2/10 most of the time. Very rarely does it go. So I know that I have a rich bias on the oxygen sensor. What do you expect to see in long term? Negative numbers. You expect to see the computer making that change. So you go, there is no change. There is no change. In fact, in long term, I know what people say, but I know what I think. I'm right. Now, this wasn't a joke. No. I think that long term should be within plus or minus 5. Until that car has a lot of miles on it, then you got to fudge it out. You got to fudge it out. You know, you get a beater that's never been maintained, and you got long term at 13. I'm not going to go find that problem, because I'm going to find $3,000 worth of problems, and they're not going to buy it anyway, right? I really only want to find what I. When I was young, I wanted to find all the problems. Now I want to find the ones I can get paid for. Right? Big things shift, you know. So anyway, you got that rich bias on the oxygen sensor, and now long term is in plus or minus 5. Yep, it's done that exponentially weighted moving average thing to the oxygen sensor. The computer was so smart it said, yo, I can't get you to run normal, and I'm in charge of the tailpipe emissions. This is what I'm going to do. You want to call that normal? That's fine. I'm going to remap my IPWs. My injector pulse width. I'm just going to remap them, and that's what we're going to do. So that's how you do tell if you've been in that shift. And then you go, okay, now this is normal. This is normal. Does that make sense? Because the computer said, now this is normal. Makes sense? All right. So in this case, no matter what you as a diagnostician see up here, this monitor's looking down here. It has nothing to do with the high voltage. Questions on it? All right. So once again, what affects lean biases? What affects an engine going lean? What if an engine doesn't go lean enough? You're running too rich? Okay. 0503, for this problem, you want to check fuel control. If fuel control is incorrect, check inputs to the PCM, and then check the oxygen sensor, and probably in that order wouldn't be bad. When I think procedure, I'm not so sure that procedures in order, I don't always do them in order. But for this particular one, because we're talking about the bottom of the sensor waveform, that's pretty much the order I would do it in. All right? Fuel control, one time, and this is just for the guys who could use a spiff in fuel control. This is not a fuel control class. All right? So what we're looking at is one of those drawn Genesis. We're looking at math, and it's up there in the right voltage, and we have short-term for bank 1-2, sensors bank 1-2, long-term for bank 1-2. Now, these are in plus or minus 5, and this, of course, isn't moving, but I'll just tell you, yeah, it's moving fine. And what we have here is plus or minus 5. I don't know what's wrong. There would be, I would say nothing's wrong with that car, right? Truck, car, I mean, isn't that good numbers? You know, when you look at those numbers, fuel trimmer is plus or minus 5, I'm happy as a pig in slop. The higher the mileage vehicle, I automatically, there's some 60,000 miles that sticks in my head. I don't know if that's the right number for everybody, because I have some 80,000 mile cars I see that are so well maintained that they're like new. Then I have some cars that have got 40,000 miles on them that people ought to be slapped for owning it. Yeah. I've seen 20,000 miles cars I hated to sit in. You know, and you've seen the whole thing. So it's sort of a fudge factor thing. And then higher than normal, the PCM is correcting for a lean. And then lower than normal, we're correcting for a rich. And now stop and think. Now this is what I think. Remember, I wanted to diagnose and jump in the middle as fast as I can, you know. So if the oxygen sensor is telling you lean, 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 and long-term is telling you high, 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 you want to check the fuel system and the O2. Always, anytime you're going to use long-term, you got to make sure you have a good oxygen sensor, because the PCM is doing its job. Here the O2 saying, I ain't got no fuel. And then the computer says, shut up, fool, I sent it. And UPS is going, I don't know where the package is. Well, UPS and this is the fuel system. They're the delivery system. They're the delivery system. The fuel system is the delivery system. I don't know what's wrong with the fuel delivery system, but it isn't doing what it's told. It's being told to deliver an additional amount of fuel to compensate for this, and it isn't. Put your scan tool down. It's not an input. It's a delivery problem. All right? If the oxygen sensor is always high and we have long-term fuel trim is low, check the fuel system, because the PCM is doing its job. Hey, I'm too rich. I can't breathe down here. And he's going, hey, I turned the fuel off. And what's happening is we've got leaky injectors or too much fuel pressure. I was just telling G when we were driving, I like to talk when he's driving, because I'm scared at 100 miles an hour. So I just talk. And I was just telling him, I was talking to a guy, and I says, did you really check fuel pressure on this car? Because I did the POM test. I was in a hurry. I was on my way to the airport when I stop and look at a car. And so I lick my palm, put it on a tailpipe, lick my palm, and I go, it's running rich. What do you know? You know, at least I know where I'm starting here. And, you know, I'm getting on an airplane, you know. And he's going on, and he tells me his old laundry list. I've done everything. And I go, you check fuel pressure? He says, I can't. I go, what do you mean you can't? And I'm thinking, it doesn't have a Schrader valve, and it's hard. You know, don't tell me it's hard. Tell me, you know, he goes, I can't. Every time I put my gauge on it, it pegs out.
Gauge working.
I go, was your gauge working yesterday? He goes, yeah, I don't know what happened to it. I go, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to kill you right now. You see that division there? If the oxygen sensor is always high and the bank is always high, here's the oxygen sensor going, man, I'm rich, I can't breathe. Here's the computer going, yeah, I know, I sent it. Now get your scan tool out. Some input is telling the computer to add fuel when you don't have to. RPM divided by maximum RPM times MAP divided by barometric pressure. That's the squirt. It has been the squirt forever. RPM divided by maximum RPM times MAP divided by barometric pressure is the squirt. Go find RPM. Who makes RPM on a car? Crankshaft. And if it doesn't have a MAP, it's got a mass airflow. You know, somebody's lying to the computer going, add more fuel, add more fuel. No, I did not see the Butthead movie. I love that movie. That's so cool. It's like so mindless. It's so great. It's like talking to technicians. In Indiana. Yeah. But can you see that? I mean, it just divides it all in half. And there's times you should not have a scan tool in your hand. You should have a pressure gauge or a lab scope looking at fuel pump waveforms, looking at injector waveforms. There's just times you should have a mason jar checking fuel volume. There's other times a scan tool is what you should have in your hand. You know? And here's the opposite. Always low. And the computer's subtracting, it goes, I got no fuel. And he goes, I know, I ain't sent none. What sensor's lying? What sensor is lying to the computer saying, we don't need no stinking fuel? You know? It's one of them made in Mexico ones, right? Don't need no stinking fuel. But here you go. Get on it. Go to work. Go do your duty, you know? Go look at your gauges and I have a rule in my shop. When that thing doesn't have a Schrader valve, another guy gets that car. You think I'm lying? You really think that's a joke? I just don't actually work. Check regulators for leakage, you know? I mean, it's not like it's brain surgery. It's really hard to connect here. You know, check for fuel volume. And while you're at it, check for cavitation, you know? I mean, it's just, you can see it. It's a clear hole. A lot of people screw this hose up on a manifold and then they replace it with black hose. How do you check for cavitation then, you know? And I've never done that. I just told you I don't even have a PDA anymore. I traded a PDA for a tablet. And the guy who got the PDA goes, did you ever think not to put any of these leads on the manifold? Any of them? I go, I didn't do it on purpose, you know? So... And then you want to test the injectors. And you know, some people say current probe. Some people say voltage. You're down there. Well, do both. I don't care what you do. But this is my idea of a perfect waveform. When I teach waveform, I have a waveform diagnostic class. We actually never really talk about anything but a form of, you know, the drawing, the trace. It's pretty cool. And this is the one we start with because this is the perfect waveform. Because right here is battery voltage, right? If this is wrong, what do you go test? Charging system, right? Charging system. You look for sulfated batteries. You look for bad cells. I mean, you're on a charging system. This is where we ground it right here. If this is too high, what do you go test? Grounds. There's no thinking. Oh, that's too high. It didn't get any lower. I know, but I like doing it. Go test your grounds. From that injector all the way through, where do grounds end? Battery negative. I mean, go, baby, go. And here's the spike after we release it. If this is wrong, what do you check? The injector. Something wrong with the injector windings. And then, of course, you're going to go back to battery voltage. And that's the most perfect waveform because every part of that waveform points to a part on a car. Now, when you look at a crank sensor, you go, yeah, well, that's the Schmidt trigger. What? No, that's the black thing. You mean a whole sensor? Yeah, that's the whole sensor. You can do that, but it's really, this is a PM sensor. You know, there's a permanent magnet sensor, and it either doesn't make voltage or it's ugly. But at GM, and I don't want to talk bad about GM because I hate them, but just because they got those rules, you know. But they take a PM sensor and they got to change the waveform. Don't they have that little square coming up on it? You know, they pulse down and square it out, and they call that a shaper? Okay, I'm asking, shaper, isn't it? And I go, okay. What do I do if the shaper's wrong? Change the sensor. Change the sensor. And here's common sense. You got a 2.5 and it's hot because you've been testing it. And it's got a bad ignition something. What do you change? Everything. Because you got a crank sensor mounted underneath a module, mounted underneath a coil pack, underneath the hot manifold. And if I'm going to take that off, everything's getting replaced. People say, well, you should test it. You can't afford to have that tested. It's cheaper for them to replace it. It's always about common sense, which I try to avoid, you know? And if you're going to test current, if you're going to do current, a good friend of mine, Glenn Young, in Houston, Texas, he's like a current probing fool. He current, you know, when you say, hey, come and help me, he brings a current probe. He does. He did a tire pressure monitor class and used a current probe. No, I didn't. You're thinking, oh, wow, that would be cool. And for you guys who are thinking, wow, that's cool, put it down. Put it down. Give it a break. You know, but, you know, here's where current flow starts. Here's our injector opening. And, you know, is that a good injector? I mean, is that one dirty or hanging up or got a bad? No, that son of a gun's clean, you know. And boom, and there's our current being held, and there's injector closes and no current. I mean, what I like about current is it tells me how much work is being done instead of the voltage. But, you know, I tend to look at both of them. Now, I don't know about you, but we use Linder's used injectors. What do you call them? Refurbished injectors. I think he does send us the used ones. He sends us the ones you send him. No, he doesn't, he goes. But, I mean, but it's still an expense for the customer, and that car's there overnight. And when we have a car overnight, we really frown on that. We really do not like to keep a car overnight. Because I'm 64, I'm the youngest guy. We may not be alive in the morning to go fix it. You know. You're laughing, but you know we have like a thing on the counter who's gonna die first, you know. And everybody put in $5, you know. And go, yeah, you're laughing like that was a joke, you know. And we weren't drunk when we did that. That was a rumor. But I am. I'm 64, and I'm the youngest guy in the shop, so we may not get there in the morning. And that's what I mean. When we have a car in the shop, we have to be there in the morning. And a lot of times we don't want to get up and go. You know, we want to like go to a prostate test or something, you know. Got to go to Walmart and buy Depends or something, you know. Test the oxygen sensor. Remember that perfect one? And there was a gentleman who was talking to me at break time, and he was working with frequencies and stuff. He may have been to John Thornton's class because John Thornton measures the frequency. I don't do it. I look at the shape of it. Is it fast enough? Is it going between 2 and 8 tenths? So I don't do the frequency. I didn't quite get what you were talking about that frequency, but John Thornton does frequency too, and I don't. And then snap it, and boom, we're done. You know, we look for bad or poor fuel control. Right here, and I know you know this because it's got the same answer as the last question I asked you. If you saw this, what's the next data bit you'd look at? Long-term fuel trim. You'd see if it's trying to make an adjustment. Is it struggling? You know, and questions in it. All right, think through the description. The oxygen sensor moves short term, which moves long term. Oxygen sensor is a result of the PCM's pulse width command and the ability of the fuel system to deliver fuel. That's what the fuel system does. The ignition to deliver spark and the engine's mechanical condition. And there you have it. Questions? The EPA proved OBD2 works. I'm telling you, it seems to work for me. So let's jump on some EVAP TIDs. And say, any questions on fuel? So, well, when we're talking about EVAP systems, going to be working with a purge solenoid. And you want to know, is it leaking or not? Is it opening and closing electrically? You want to talk about a canister, and they always place canisters in a safe place. Chrysler minivans cracked because of curbs, you know? And you can tell, you don't even have to clean the mud off it because that stamped metal thing beside it's bent too, you know? And if they bent that, they broke the canister, you know? And fuel tank pressure sensors. Here's a vent for, this is a GM Chevy truck in between the body and the bed of the truck. And you can actually work on it if I have the lift up this about this far, and I can work on it there. And I got one of those Carlos long probe things, you know, you working on that sucker. That's a great vent. And I live in a rural area, and these get all plugged up. And how do we diagnose these? The tanks collapsed. Fuel tanks collapsed. And they go, we had to replace your fuel tank, and we cleaned your vent. You know, and then of course for leaks, and of course that's backwards. Remember? Did you find out the hard way or the easy way? Oh, somebody told you. And then we may have a leak detection pump if we have a Chrysler, and then of course Chrysler now has natural vacuum leak detection, which is the most. For the guys who got the Chrysler disc, you really want to watch that because that is the most simplest EVAP testing system I've ever seen. They got a switch. The only input to the computer is a switch. It's cool. All right. So here's a GM EVAP loading test. And here, you know, it's got two, you know. If it gets a 0, 100, it passed. If it gets a 0, it passed the limit, and it passed the value here. If it gets all zeros, it's not run at all. It's a preliminary test. It's just a test to see if we can do another test. This test does not pass, the PCM is going to do a low vacuum test. And here's how you test that stuff. When you're looking at this, you're going to graft your scantle, you know. Purge percent is based off short-term fuel trim. And what's going to happen is, on these cars, the computer is going to purge, and then it's going to look at short-term fuel trim to see how much it moved. Because the next time it opens purge, it's going to say, hey, last time I opened purge, I had to shift 5% in short term. That means there's a lot of vapors in there. And it'll go, you ever see purge at 100% on a car? Yeah, okay, so trust me. You see purge at 100%, that means what? There ain't no vapors in the canister. It's not a loaded canister. So what's happening in this particular test, the computer's opening the purge valve, looking at short-term fuel trim, and you know what it's doing? It's seeing if the canister's loaded or not. All right? So here we got short-term at 1.6 and purge at 0 here. You can see we're going to jump up to 12%. Sometimes it'll jump up to 23%. Sometimes the initial jump will be 90%. And people are saying, I don't understand. The last red car I had was 27%. The thing is, this is set by how much fuel vapor is in there. The last time you tested a GM, was it hot and you were on black asphalt? Is there a lot of vapors in that canister on that day? Yeah, so when it shifted short-term when it opened purge 12%, it shifted long-term to -5 or something, -6 or something. So that's how the computer knows where to set purge at. But on a Ford's, it's a little bit different. You take my F-150, every time it jumps to 27%, no matter what, hot, cold weather, engine hot, cold, it always jumps to 27%. My F-250, for example, jumps to 13% every time. My Ford Tauruses, I have some Ford Tauruses for the guys that get around the farm. It's a great four-wheel drive car. Well, we bought out a fleet of them. And what happens, those tend to jump, depending on model year, 15, 16, 18, or 19%. So Fords have a predetermined, where am I going to jump first at? But on Chrysler and on GM, it's all set by how much fuel vapor. They do a loading test. Does that make sense? They do a load test. How much is in there? All right. So you can see here, short term goes down, and at 12%, was there vapors in there? Yeah. So it was loaded. The vapors from the canister entered the engine, and we got the oxygen sensor moving, and the short term moved, and we did all that. Oh, look what else it means. When you see that, when short term shifted, the good news is, are the hoses connected? Yeah, is the vent plugged? No, you can't put a vacuum on it when that vent's plugged. And did the purge open? See what you know just from that? You're just looking at that 12% shift we saw here? You can make an instant. My driveway is 1.9 miles an hour. That's my test drive. I go down to get the mail. It's a test drive. No? But the point is, I'm not even halfway down the driveway yet. I'm not even a quarter way down the driveway yet, and I'm getting purge, and I know a lot of stuff. You know? It also establishes initial purge percentage, as we just told you. All right? And look at it creep up here. Look at it creep up here. They're saying, oh, I didn't get too much, didn't get too much, didn't get too, oh, got a lot. All right, the PCM knows there's very little vapors. When the short term goes up, it purges. And if you have no vapors, what do you get? You get air. So short term goes up to compensate for the additional oxygen. And you say, holy cow, is your vent plugged? No. Is your purge open? You know, you got fresh air through it, so you ought to get vapors through it. Questions on this one? Because that's a loading test. This is GM data. Look what happens, and this is over. You know, we go from zero, canister purge, whatever that is, 16 or 17, I don't know what it is. And then what happens, we lose short term. Why? Because the oxygen sensor went rich. So there it is with the oxygen sensor. You know? And here, we opened, purged the same amount, and oxygen sensor went lean because we took an extra, and now it's subtracted. Here we're going to 50%, and look at the highest on this one. This test drive, we went up to 97%. Is this canister loaded? No, we're just sucking in fresh air. So if it fails this test, it's going to do a low or weak vacuum test. That's really what that was. Let me just show you this. When you read in these descriptions low or weak vacuum, they're not talking about bad. When they say low vacuum test, weak vacuum test, they're not talking about bad. Because it is low vacuum and it is low pressure. And I just put the I just went to www.unitconverter.com, and I type in PSI, and I get inches of water. So one PSI is 27 inches of water. So we're dealing with really small numbers. And Chrysler's natural vacuum never sees over 4 or 5 inches of water. All right? Now, and I am jumping around, but I want to show you something on this test. I'm going to go back here, and this is called the low or the weak vacuum test instead of low. Here's what happens. We have a fuel tank pressure sensor here, and this is a GM low tank pressure sensor. And at zero, what does the sensor read? 1.4 to 1.6. So what do you know now when you see that statistic? 1.5 is normal. What should a FTP read on a GM? 1.56. I see a million of them at 1.56. All right? So what happens here, if the purge solenoid, if it passed a certain test, it's going to do this test. So what happens is it purges, the purge solenoid is cycled. You know, it's pulsed on and off, and it tries to create a vacuum. and the vent solenoid is closed, and if there's no leak, do we draw a vacuum? Yeah, we and it expects to see 3.10 to 2.6 volts, somewhere in there, and that it's a, hey, I can pull this weak vacuum. There's no leak. The hoses are connected. There's no crack in the canister. See how they do these tests? If you failed this test, what would be the first thing you'd want to know? I'd want to know, is a purge solenoid working?
And is there vacuum to it?
You know, is there vacuum to it? Is the, you know, I pop off the vacuum side of the purge hose, and I expect it to feel vacuum there. I don't really measure it. Sorry. I just feel it with my palm. But I'm also on bi-directional, and I'm controlling the purge. And the engine's running. I go, I got vacuum to it. We're talking about such low vacuum, I'm not going to get a gauge out there. I don't have a gauge. Remember, one PSI is 27 inches of water. You have to use a manometer. I was going to say a magnometer, but a manometer. And I have them. I paid $4 for them. They're expensive. I don't want to use them. They're just hard to connect, so whatever. But then if I have a purge solenoid that's working and I can't pass this test, I'm all over the leak. I'm all over the leak. I'm all over it. And the first thing I do with a leak test is I do a flow test. If you notice, my thumb is not on the smoke machine's hose and the ball goes up. When I don't have a leak, the ball stays down. So you can see that if I had a leak, the ball's going up. If I don't have a leak in the system, the ball's going down. So I have an adapter. I go to the green cap and I try to tighten that Schrader valve as tight as I can get it, and then I remember it's backwards and I back it out. Right? So I get my flow tester working up here. I put my shop air to my machine, and this has a manifold in it to bring the pressure, shop pressure way, 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 way down. And I start testing, you know. And you can calibrate with this machine. You can push the buttons and calibrate for a 20 and a 40 thousandths leak. You know, so what I do is I test with the vent open. Because if I had a restriction, it's going to cause the ball to be lower than normal. Remember, it goes up on a leak. If the vent's open, it should go all the way to the top. But if it's lower anywhere down here and it's not at the top, I know I have a restriction in the system. Does that make sense? You know? You know, here's normal. Where's my ball? It's underneath here. It's right here, really. You know? And now I have a slight restriction. Here, I have no flow at all, right? So, there it is. See, it was under there. So there's my restriction. And there's, I mean, it's just blocked. But here, I'm going to go to the vent valve. If you can't close it bi-directional, and then I'm going to close it with, I'm going to connect a jumper lead to it, and I'm going to close it with a ground, for gosh sakes. You know, but I want to close that vent solenoid. Once I know I don't have a restriction, I want to see if I got a leak. Now, if you have bi-directional on that particular car, go for it, babe, right? All right. If I don't have bi-directional, I'm going to have to find the wire. It is in this particular car. It's a white one. That's a WT right there. There I found my white wire, and I'm just going to connect a back probe to it, and I'm going to ground it. Now, I will tell you, on this type of testing, I have a ground wire in my hand. Well, I have a ground wire that's probably 20, 30 feet long. No, it's not 30, but it's probably 20. And it's got an alligator clamp on one side and a big bulk of solder on the other. And I go up to the battery, and I make sure that alligator clamp's on there. And when I'm under there testing stuff, I have a ground. Did you ever ground it? And then you start wiggling the ground to see if you got a good ground. I just don't do that. I just put that ground right here. And when I need a ground on the scope or voltmeter or whatever I'm doing, I pull that sucker out, and I got me a battery ground right there, so I'm happy with it. And that's what I do, all right? So the flow meter should indicate no flow with the vent closed. If mode 6 shows a failure for a leak and the flow meter shows no leak, check for an intermittent problem with the vent. And that means ground, unground, ground, unground, unground, and, you know, play with the vent. Cycle it a couple times. Whack it. Cycle the vent open and close. See if you can make it leak. All right? And then if the monitor's failing and I can't get this to pass this, I'll blow smoke. I'll blow smoke, you know. I'm not so sure I do this calibration. I did it for the class, but I want the ball to move. I don't care if I'm looking for 20,000s, 22,000s. I really don't care.
Acceptable size leak
in it. Yeah, I'm just trying to find a leak. And I've told this 1,000 times. There's been times when I wouldn't have found a leak with anything other than a smoke machine. Some of those top of the gas tank leaks. And there's times I wouldn't have found it if you couldn't smell the smoke because you couldn't see it. So, I mean, I'm a big smoke machine fan. Star, this is the big guys on the block. They sell to all the manufacturers. Their tool is essential tool in domestic dealers. There's times when you cannot see exactly where the smoke's coming from, down in there somewhere, and that's where the dye comes in. They got this thing called UltraTrace UV dye, and you take your AC light and you hold the black light and you hold it up under there. And that works real well. So, and I don't care. And I still have shops that they believe testing a gas cap is replacing it. All right. And I this is one that I took. Why would you take a photograph of a gas cap? Because he told me it didn't leak. Is that got moisture in there? Is that a good gas cap? Huh? Okay, here's a real quick one. I'll just jump to tell you the whole story. Here's what happens. A purge test. They're going to test the purge valve. The computer's going to close the vent, seal the system, and then it's going to leave closed, the purge valve. With the vent closed and the purge valve closed, should this system see any vacuum? No, the FTP should stay flat. But if it creeps up, the purge valve's leaking. That's how they test the purge valve. Questions on that? Questions at all? I got pictures of stuff. Here's the natural vacuum for GM. What happens here is they're going to use the FTP voltage right here. And then they're going to shut the engine off and they're going to start looking at it. What happens? Pressure builds up from vapors, right? Now the voltage is backwards. When pressure goes up, voltage goes down on a GM. On a Ford, it's vice versa. When pressure goes up, voltage goes up. But on a GM, when pressure goes up in the EVAP system, voltage goes down on the fuel tank pressure. GM's backwards. Except for Dave. But I don't like him. What happens is when pressure builds up to a certain pre-programmed number, it opens the vent and boom, what happens? It jumps back up here. This is the natural vacuum cycle. Now, what is the fuel going to do after it gets hotter? It's going to cool down. The big molecules become little molecules and we were left with what? Space or a vacuum. And you can see what happens. Right through our, it's going to watch this pressure, this voltage here, make the change through a natural vacuum as it's going to cool off. Boom. Right there. Builds up and decays. Check for leaks if it fails. One thing on Chrysler, they have a lot of modes. This is actually the one I was looking for. They have a lot of TIDs, and actually it's not a lot, it's 51, 52, 53, but they all do the same thing. It's actually a purge flow test, but on some models, they use the idle air control. They open the purge, close the purge, open the purge, close the purge, and they watch the IAC. Do the same thing, and they watch short term, do the same thing, and they change engine speed. They watch the change in engine speed. So as per model year, model whatever, what's going to happen there is you're going to have, and if you follow the description, it's going to tell you purge flow test versus IAC, purge flow test versus STFT, and purge flow test versus RPM. And that's what you got to use. So they have the same test. But in model years, they change it from what they're going to compare it to. And that's the one I was looking for, because that one confuses you, because you see it once, and then you go, oh yeah, they're going to compare it to IAC. No, this year they're going to compare it to short-term field trim. Next year they're compare it to the engine RPM. Really want to thank you there. I'm around. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay.
Well, we'd like to thank Doc, obviously. He did a great job. You. And Dave. So give him another round of applause for those guys.
Dave did a good job, boy.